Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here today in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. And this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping this hour coming up we can be an inspiration to you here as well as you out in the radio listening audience. And we always want to insist upon you getting on the phone out there in the radio listening audience and calling a friend and have them to tune in. Get the Northside Baptist Church Hour, especially a shut-in. If you'll do that today, you'll be doing them a great favor. Be doing us a favor, and we appreciate it so very much. So we welcome you here. Good to see our friends back from Silver, North Carolina. Appreciate them being here in the service again today, the Deals. And so good to see every one of you. May the good Lord bless you. And I do want to thank every one of you for wishing me a happy birthday. And some of you gave me cards, and some of the cards had a gift in them, and I appreciate it so very much. I want you to know that. God bless you. Everything you've ever done for this unworthy preacher is deeply appreciated from the depths of my heart. And I want you to know I love you and appreciate you. I'm going to speak today on the need of the local church. I'm not sure the number of the tape. I believe it's tape 332. Can somebody help me there? 332. Was it 331 last Sunday? 331. Helen says 331 last Sunday. All right, 332 today. And you can write in and get this tape. I'll tell you this song by this little Filipino lady on this special Memorial Weekend, and they're Navy people and soon be traveling, be worth the entire tape. They brought a friend, Rose, and her children along, our loved ones, with them, and we appreciate that. And so we just appreciate every one of you. May God bless you. Write in and get the tape. They're $3 each. And just say, Preach Edward, send me tape number 332 or send me the tape on the needs of the local church. My text is Acts chapter 9. But before I get into my text, I have a few things to say. Number one, I want to say that I'm now in the process of reprinting my book on the 52 7-point outlines on the Holy Spirit. Now, just about run out of my old copies. I printed many, many years ago. And we're putting a new green cover on it. And on the back of the book will be one of the latest pictures of my wife and myself on the back of the little book. If you have pests in your garden or your house, you just set that up and they see that picture of mine, then they'll sket. And so the picture would be worth something in that respect. It would be a beautiful little book, 52 7-point outlines on the Holy Spirit. Now, this book has been used by preachers, by Sunday school teachers, by lay speakers, by just faithful students of God's Word, and it can be very helpful. Had people call me from way out west, say, Preach Edwards, can I use that book in my Sunday school department? It's used on Wednesday night services. And it's a book that's very helpful, but this is the catch. If you want to call it a catch, it catches me all right. It's going to cost me almost $800 to do this reprint. Now, by the time I pay for the picture and the envelopes and the tax, it's going to be at least $800, $732 for the reprint. I'm taking this step by faith. I'm asking God to help me get this book reprinted and get it out because the need is so great. And it can be such a great blessing to get this printed messages, outlines into the hands of people that appreciate it. And if you're interested in it and you want to have a part in it, I'm praying that God will move upon somebody's heart to stand by me and help me take care of this reprinting. It's investing in a great cause in the work of God and in heaven. And so I want you to think about it and pray about it. And if you want to write to me, my mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is a zip code number. So you write to me, let me hear from you. I kindly feel like that God's going to lay it on somebody's heart to have a part in helping me reprint this booklet. I want to get it out to hundreds of people, preachers and Bible teachers and whatnot. And it's a good way to help people in the work of God. Letters I want to read here because the need is so great. And you're interested in this ministry, I'm sure. I have a letter here from Lincolnton, Georgia. Dear Dr. Edwards, I am a disabled Korean vet. I listen every Sunday on the radio to you and think you're the best. I can't go to church, but after hearing you, I feel like I've been there. I've heard you talk a lot on these subjects. I'm clipping, I notice he said, I'm clipping this part out of the Augusta Chronicle. I clipped it out yesterday and I wanted you to read it. Here is another man that bleeds like we do. I'm 60 years old. I think you may be a little older. I've heard you say that you were in World War II. Thank you for the good preaching. Then it's signed Edward Graves, end quote. Now I'm going to read to you the clipping that he sent me from the paper down in Augusta. It says, slam judiciary stupid decisions. Editor, I quote, once again, our stupid judicial system has blown another one. The jury members who did not give Wayne Carl Coleman the death penalty for the all-day murders should be put on trial along with the incompetent judges who allowed the retrial. Stupid decisions such as these will have many effects. Number one, more people will buy guns for self-protection with only a few knowing how to use them. Therefore, more accidental shootings will occur. More people will take the law in their own hands. I know I will, he said. Lawyers, judges, and jurors will be given less respect by youngsters because the negative comments they would hear from their parents about this lack of justice. Mine have heard plenty. Criminals will view this as a sign that they can perform the most hideous crimes and not have to pay the price. Death is not pretty in any situation, but some deterrent must be imposed by society on irresponsible people like Coleman, who had no respect for honest people's right to live in a full life. These criminals are nothing but terrorists, just like the Iranians, and the death penalty for such actions should be swift and sure. Signed, David Marcus, Waynesboro, Georgia, end quote. I agree with that 100%. Now the judges have turned these criminals loose, and that means you're going to have to get your gun. Now these liberals are whining and moaning and about handguns, so easy to get. And they are so responsible for people are having to get these guns, just like he was talking about here. These liberal, ungodly, crime-loving judges and lawyers that's turning these criminals loose are responsible for causing law-abiding citizens to have to buy guns to protect their business and to protect their homes. Now, you better believe that. And that's a good article came out of that paper. I just read it to you. Last night, I saw on the news where there's some young people went to a party or a dance on the way back. About three or four or five boys in an automobile. The driver jumped out of the automobile, took a gun, fired it into a group of other young people in front of him, hit a young, beautiful girl in the head, killed her instantly, put two men in the hospital, and they jumped in their car and took off. Now, let me tell you something. As long as we are not punishing criminals, you're going to get more and more and more of that kind of stuff. If we'll crank up the electric chair and put these people to death, and they'll stop a lot of that foolishness, and these liberal judges and appeal court judges and lawyers are responsible largely for this mess. Down in Augusta last week, there was a judge down there that had a man on death row, been there 14 years. He was a black man. He'd killed a white policeman. They sentenced him to death 14 years ago. They let him sit there 14 years, which is a very, very stupid thing to do. And then the lawyer comes along and talks to the judge, and the judge said, well, I understand they didn't have any black people on the jury. They had all white people, yes? All right, he said, we'll give him a new trial or we'll turn him loose. Beloved, it doesn't make any difference whether it's white, black, red, or yellow. Doesn't make any difference who's on the jury. If a man commits a cold-blooded murdered crime, then he's to die. That's what God said. God said his penalty, his punishment is death. And these people, judges like that, and the judges like the Three Stooges that overrode the All-Day Family conviction, and people like that are filling this country with criminals and turning them loose and forcing law-abiding citizens to have to protect their homes and their families and their business. And you're going to have to do it, brother, but unless we can get rid of some of these ignorant lawyers and judges that don't care anything about the victim or care nothing about the suffering of the victim's people, unless you can get them out of the seat where they're sitting calling themselves judges and do away with them or get them out, take the job away from them, that means buy you guns. You got to have them. You got to protect your home because they're filling the land with criminals. Oh, you say, preacher, I just don't like that. I don't care whether you like it or not. If you don't like it, you can leap it, lump it, leave it, jump up and bump it, or whatever you want to. It's the truth anyhow. And you know I'm telling you the truth. Now, that's not my message. I got another letter here I want to read, and I'll get into the message and listen to what this letter has to say. It's a different type letter, and this letter is coming from up in North Georgia, Tocoa, Georgia, I believe it is. Dear Brother Edwards, and I quote, I just wanted to write you and tell you, I listen to you most of the time. I like a man that has got the guts enough to say what he thinks. I think me and you stand for the same things. I am sending you this gift in memory of my mother. Mother stayed in the nursing home up in Clayton for about 2 years. I would go to see her every Sunday. And they would have church early and she would want me to tune in you before I left. There were a lot of people listening to you in the home, and I think your broadcast does more good than most people realize. Unquote. That's part of that letter. I just wanted to pass that on to you to let you know that God is using the ministry, and I thank God for what He's doing. I am a Bible-believing, fundamental Baptist conservative, and I'm against these radical liberals, infidels, hellraisers, crime lovers, howlings, and venal people that's turning criminals loose, and I'll tell them to their face as quick as I'll tell you here in this church auditorium. And if you don't want to know the truth and don't want to hear the truth, you stop your ears up, but I'm going to tell it anyhow. Because it's needed. We need more men to stand up. Our governor stood up against the decision made by this Coleman case and opened his mouth, but I don't know if he's done anything about it. People in authority has got to do something about it. And unless we get behind them and let them know where we stand and let them know what we want done, they're not going to do it. They're afraid of their little vote. They're afraid of minority groups, and they jump around like a burnt-toed, hen-toed priest, and they're afraid somebody's going to vote against them. The true red-blooded, law-abiding citizens of the state of Georgia is going to have to stand up on your hind legs and let people know where you stand, what you believe in, and we're not going to be run over in this country by this gang of people. I'll tell you, we got enough of it and too much of it, and something's got to happen. Something's got to be changed. As certain as I'm speaking to you today. Now, that's not my message. I'm not going to charge anything for that. I'm just giving you what you ought to get and what you need, whether you like it or not. Now, in Acts chapter 9 and verse 31, then had the churches rest throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria, and were edified and walked in the fear of the Lord, and the comfort of the Holy Ghost were multiplied. Now, the Bible said, then had the churches rest, and they walked in the fear of God, and they were multiplied. People got saved. Things were happening. Now I'm going to speak to you briefly today on the need of the local church. Now the Northside Baptist Church here is a local church. You have other local churches. The Bible teaches such. Jesus had the local church established. Paul wrote to the local churches. And they're very important. I wouldn't want to live in a nation where they had no local church. I would want to live in a world where there's no local church. I wouldn't want to live in a community where there's no local church unless I could get one started. Now we need today more people fully surrendered to God in our local churches. We play in religion. We come in half-hearted. Not coming in a worshipful attitude, surrendering to God, letting God speak to our hearts. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 5, they did not as hope, but first gave themselves to the Lord and unto us for the will of God. Paul is saying here to this church, he said they gave themselves first of all to God, then gave us into service for the Lord. Your primary and first obligation is to give yourself wholly to God. You belong to God. Your body belongs to God. In Luke chapter 14 and verse 26, if any man come to me and hate not my father, or rather hate not his father and mother and wife, and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. Now that word hate is not the same word hate we use today. It means that you're not to let your parents, your brothers, your sisters, your wife, your husband, anybody come between you and your responsibility and your service to God. Paul said in Romans chapter 12, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now God has a claim on your body, and you'll never know the perfect will of God unless you say, God, here am I, take me, take my body. It's a holy vessel. It's dedicated to you. It's yours. And let God use that body. And when you do that, God can bless you and use you if you say, here I am, Lord. That great Jewish evangelist many years ago, Hammond Alpman, he's gone on to be with God now. And for a Jew to get converted to be caught in the ministry and enter into a seminary to train for the ministry, that means his people, as a general rule, turn against him. And he left one of the northern states and went out into Texas, attending a seminary out there. He had a father and mother back north, hair as white as snow, getting up in years, and they didn't like what Hyman did. And the dad said, I'm going back, mother. You're not able to go. Now I'm going to talk to our son and see if he won't give up that thing you call preaching in the ministry and come back and take over the business. We don't have long on the earth, and he can be a wealthy man. We don't like what he's doing. So he went to Texas. And he stayed there about a week begging Hammond to give up the ministry and give up Jesus Christ. Board the train, go back up north, take over the business. Hammond said, Daddy, I can't do it. I can't do it. I've yielded to God. I can't do it. And his daddy, he followed his daddy to the train. And his daddy placed his foot up on the step of the train to get on the train. And his tears running down his cheeks, his hair as white as snow, his shoulders stooped. Hammond standing there crying, and Hammond said, Daddy, I may never lay eyes on you and mother again, but I want you to tell my precious mother that I love her very much. But Daddy, I want you and mother both to know I love Jesus more than anything in the world, and I'm going to serve Jesus. And he turned and walked away, never to see his daddy and mother alive anymore. Beloved, it'll cost you something to serve God when you put it all on the altar. There was a man by the name of Polycarp. Polycarp was a minister yonder in Ephesus in the first century. Served God faithfully. And when they brought him to the stake and going to burn him at the stake, they asked him when he renounced Jesus Christ. He said, for 86 years, my Lord has been good to me, and I'm not going to deny him now. And they struck the match. Are you willing to pay the price? We need people that are firmly standing for God. In Philippians chapter 4 and verse 1, therefore, my brethren and dear beloved, as long for my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. In Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 11, it says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. God wants people to stand. If we have churches doing anything for God, we got to have some people that will stand and not just play around about the matter. People is full surrendered. People are stand. Number three, we need people that are fighting soldiers. We're in a battle. We're in the army of God, and we need fighting soldiers in this army. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 3, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. It'll cost you something to serve God. You can't sit at home on Wednesday night and say, well, I'm a little too tired to go. If you're a soldier of the cross worth the spiritual salt in your bread, you wouldn't let that keep you at home. But if you're one of these lazy soldiers that give in to your feelings, there'll be a lot of times when you ought to be serving God and you're not. In Psalms 144 and verse 1, blessed be the Lord my strength, which teaches my hands to war and my fingers to fight. We need to realize that God is looking for good hardened soldiers today that will pay the price. Come to church many times, whether they feel like it or not. Willing to pay the price for the glory of God. Faithful service of Jesus Christ. We need people like that. Number four, we need people that are faithful servants. In Matthew chapter 25, verse 21, his Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I make thee rule over many things. Into thine the joy of the Lord. Faithful, faithful. Revelation chapter 2 and verse 10, be thou faithful unto death, I will give thee a crown of life. God wants faithful church members. I mentioned this before, but it thrills my heart every time I think about it. We had a precious couple that lived up near Jefferson many years ago. They're in heaven today. Brother Curtis Potts and Fleeta Potts. They're the most faithful members that walked through those doors back there. And one morning it was snowing and ice on the ground, and you could hardly get out of the driveway. And I said to my wife, I said, honey, there won't be anybody at church today that can't get out of the driveway. And I looked out the window, and lo and behold, what did I see? There came a Curtis and Fleeta Potts sliding in to the churchyard. They skidded and slid and drove and came all the way from Jefferson to be in church that morning. Faithful, most faithful you've ever seen. We have some faithful ones now, but you won't find anybody more faithful than they were. The night he took seriously ill, whenever he paid his last visit here at Northside, he had a terrible problem. He had a blood vessel about ready to burst for a period of time. And the doctor told him it could happen at any time, but he did not recommend surgery. On the way to church that night, they were coming down the 441, and Curtis said to his wife, Fleeter, he said, honey, I'm sick. You'll have to drive. And she said, all right, I will. She got on the steering wheel. She said, Coot, do you want to go to the hospital at Commerce? Do you want to go to the hospital at Athens? Or do you want to go home? Do you want to go to church? You know what he said? He says, take me to church. There was a man deathly sick. They brought him to church, let him out here in front of the church, and helped him in. He was white as a sheet. I put my arm around him. I said, Deacon, you're a sick man. We got to get you to the hospital. And we rushed him to the hospital in the Commerce. And when he reached there, they saw the seriousness of his problem. They said, rush him to Athens. And they notified us he's in Athens. We went to Athens. And there that night, I went into the emergency room while he was working, one of these greatest deacons I've ever worked with in my life. Now, I'll never forget the words he said to me. He looked up at me, his face as white as chalk. He said, Pastor, I'm dying. And there they took my great deacon out, carried him to the emergency room, carried him in the hospital room to operate on him. That good old doctor, I won't call his name, but he came out, good old doctor, and he said to me, he said, Preacher, if this man pulls through, God will have to pull him through. I'm going to do the best I can. Let's have prayer. That doctor fell down on his knees, began to pray. We began to pray, and we prayed a long prayer. The doctor got up with a heavy heart, went back in there to perform surgery, ran 16 pints of blood through his body, and he died and went on home to be with God. My, what a faithful man. And his wife followed suit. His wife's mother and daddy were members of this church at Northside for years. And the Potts family were members here for 20-some-odd years. I preached Mrs. Potts' daddy's funeral right here at Northside. I preached at dear mother's funeral here at Northside. They love their church. They love their pastor. And I don't know anybody that loved this church and loved their pastor any more than Fleeter and Curtis Potts. And when Curtis Potts died, Fleeter said to me, he said, Pastor, you know, I love my church and we love our pastor. And she said, when I die, I want you to preach my funeral like you did my husband's. I want you to preach in the Northside Baptist Church like you did my husband and like you did my mother and dad. I said, Fleeter, I will if I possibly can. I surely will. I see that it's done. But I didn't get the privilege to do that. bunch of God haters, people deprived her of being having a funeral preached in this church, deprived her of having the request she made, deprived her of having her dear pastor she loved dearly, and being placed in the church she loved dearly. Those people deprived her of that privilege. Beloved, they're going to answer to God for it as certain as I'm facing you today. I'd hate to face God in this. I don't see how people can live under a situation like that. It seems to me like their conscience would drive them up the wall to treat a poor soul that loved God and loved a church and loved a pastor like she did, and most faithful and been serving God here more than 20 years, to deprive her of having a funeral here in her own church and her own pastor preaching that funeral. How low down can people be? They can get pretty low, and you're welcome whether you like it or not. And so we find people are faithful. We need to have faithful people to serve God, and you can't get anything done unless you have faithful people to do it. Now we need people that are financial supporters. Financial supporters. Beloved, you can't build a church unless you have faithful tithers and givers above their tithes. Now you listen to me. You listen, let me have your ears, put your feet on the floor and look at the preacher. When you got seven deacons on the deacon board, and about three of them drop their offerings in on Sunday, and about four of them do not, what kind of example are you setting before the church? Oh, you say, preacher, that happened here at Northside. No, not every Sunday. Once in a while, probably. Now you listen to me. Every deacon ought to set an example of tithing his income into the work of God. The pastor ought to do it. The associate pastor ought to do it. Sunday school teachers ought to do it. In fact, every Christian ought to do it and support the work of God, that you'd have money to take care of God's work as you sojourn. And when you fail to do it, you're doing wrong. When a deacon fails to tithe, he's robbing God. He's setting a bad example. When a teacher fails to tithe, they're robbing God. When a church member fails to tithe, they're robbing God. Do you think God can bless a bunch of robbers? Absolutely not. God will shut up the windows of heaven and withdraw his blessings whenever you turn out to be a God robber. When you tithe your income, which is 10%, one little thin dime out of every dollar you earn, and you ought to give gifts above that, and you ought to be consistent, and you ought to do it every time you draw your income, whether it be weekly, monthly, or however often you get it, you ought to see that God's part is taken out, and that's God's holy money. That's not yours. If you spend that on yourself, you're stealing God's money, you're robbing God. And do you think God's going to bless you? You think God's going to help you on your job, in your business, in your home? No, sir. God will come around as a good collector if you're saved. And when God moves in to collect that, it's going to hurt. I mean, it's going to hurt when God starts collecting those back tithes and offerings that you took away from God and spent them on yourself. You have no right to spend one dime of God's holy tithe on yourself. I don't care what you spend it for. That's God's holy money. That's to be used to take care of God's work, getting out the gospel. And you have no right to touch it. That's not yours. Now, if you want to take a gift above that and do other things with it, that's your business if you want to support God's work otherwise. But that holy tithe is the Lord's money. It ought to be connected where you worship God, in the church where you worship God, and used to the glory of God, and everybody work together, and God will do wonders. Now, you got to be faithful. If you expect it, you can't do it one Sunday and miss the next Sunday. Do it the next Sunday, miss two Sundays. Rob God today and give a little next week, and next week rob God again and give a little. No, that's inconsistency. God can't bless that. You have responsibility, and you go and ask God for that responsibility. As certain as you're sitting back there, there's some of you, you've heard me preach for years and years and years about what you ought to do about your tithes and offerings, and you haven't done anything about it yet. It's costing you. It's costing. You're not going to get your head above the water. You're not going to get on your feet. You're not going to get anything accomplished if you're a born again believer. You're not going to do it. God's going to collect as certain as I'm speaking to you today. That's the word of God. If that's not the word of God, I don't know the word of God. I've tithed ever since God saved me, and God's taken care of my need, and God will take care of yours. Number six, we need people that will go after sinners. go after a lot of people you don't get, but you get a lot of people you don't go after. But go after that you would not, if you go after that you don't go after, then you can get some, a lot of people that you don't get. Now let me give you that again. You go after a lot of people you don't get, but you get a lot of people you don't go after, that you would not get if you had not gone after a lot of people that you don't get. Now, what are you saying, preacher? I'm saying in order to have a spiritual church, a church of the glory of God, then, beloved, listen to me. You gotta go after them. Nowhere did God tell that sinner to come to church. God said for that sinner to be won by the Christian when he goes after him. Now, if you can get him in and let him hear the gospel, well and good. You're lucky if you get sinners to church today. This world's got them tied up and ensnared, and you're lucky if you get sinners to church. But if you do, thank God for it. But it's our responsibility to go after them. Go get them and bring them in to the glory of God and let God save them and speak to them. Witness to them out there wherever you talk to them. The early church went after sinners. Philip the evangelist went after sinners. One the Ethiopian eunuch. And Andrew went after his brother Simon Peter. And Jesus met the woman at the well. Jesus talked to Nicodemus. Winning people to God personally, going after people, is a great way to get the job done. I could stand here for 2 solid hours and tell you about people, peculiar things that happened by God Almighty permitting me to come in contact with people in my ministry. We need to realize that. That was a great preacher yonder in Tennessee, Dr. Robinson, Dr. Lee Robinson. Lee Robinson run a big tent meeting down in Birmingham, Alabama. Had about 2,000 people there in that tent meeting. And the back of the tent was toward the highway. And he was facing the highway and the people was facing him. In that service that night, a young smart-aleck boy came riding up by the tent on a motorcycle. And stomped down on it, caused to make a lot of noise. Said, amen, hallelujah, praise God. Then drove off. That night when Dr. Robinson gave the invitation, there was a man and his wife and a young girl about 20 years old came down, was gloriously saved. They rejoiced, they praised God. Well, just a little while after that, about 1 o'clock that morning, that same boy that rode by on that motorcycle wrapped the thing around a telephone post and killed him instantly. When Dr. Robinson went to try to comfort the family, it was hard to do. Daddy said, oh, I loved him so much. He is my only son, and I appreciate him so much. He always paid his bills, and he seemed to be a good boy. His mother said, oh, how we loved him and trusted him. It wasn't like my boy to do what he did last night. We loved him so much. Then his sister laid her hand over on his body and said, my brother, my brother, my brother, I loved you so much. But there they buried that boy, died no doubt without God. Whenever after the burial, they had the funeral in that tent. And after the meeting, after the funeral, the pastor came up and tears rolling down his cheeks. He said, Dr. Robinson, he said, I passed by that house 5 and 6 times every day. Now, I've done it for years. He said, I didn't know those lost people were there. I never went in to see if they were there. I didn't just go in to check on him. He said, that boy's blood's on my hands. He said, my hand's dripping now with that boy's blood. And God's going to hold me responsible. Oh, dear people, we must go after them if we're going to get them to God. We need people that realize that the going, drawing of the Lord, coming of the Lord draweth nigh. And if there's ever a time that you want to do something for God, strengthen your church, build your church, whether you like the preacher or not, whether you like maybe somebody in the church or not, you do God's work. Whether you like the way the preacher preaches, how he looks, you do the work of God. That's beside the point. It's serving God and working for God, being faithful to God and faithful in your church. That's going to really count in that hour. You need to be faithful to God. Now you can write in and get this tape number 332. Or you can call this tape by the title, entitled Needs of the Local Church. And write in and get it if you like to have it. God bless you. You've listened well. I want you to take this message home with you and let it sink down into your heart. Let's stand to our feet. Father in heaven, I do pray I do pray, Jesus, in thy holy name, that you'll use this message, that your name might be honored, that Jesus might be glorified. God, I've given the need of our church and every church in this community and every church in this nation. Lord, we need thee. And I pray that you'll help us and speak to every heart, my Father, and may Jesus be glorified. Have your way in the invitation in Christ's name, I ask it. Amen. Amen. Now, Debbie's going to play for us. Are you listening to me? As she plays, now, I don't know whether God spoke to you or not. God gave me the message. It's entirely up to you as well. You accept it, rebel against it, or reject it. That's up to you. That's a matter between you and God. You'll certainly have to answer God for it. And God is speaking to you to get saved, come back to God, or unite with this church, or come and rededicate your life to God, or come and confess your sins to God. Whatever God tells you to do, while Debbie plays, I want you to come. Come on. Tony's here to help us. I'm here to help you.